The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network.
This is what we can look forward to on episode 268 of Skywalking Through Neverland.
Of the dozens and dozens of stories in your book, I think that one's my favorite.
Who we might know who was a fan of Star Wars? Jimmy Carter was president at the time.
Yeah, although there is some downside to it, is that the ride does break down.
It was an exciting time, and we were kind of making things up as we went along on, you know, promoting Star Wars and Empire.
Because you're both so small and cute.
Aw, I'll take that.
Send your emails to willsmithandtomholland@gmail.com.
How can it be a Star Wars event without you guys?
And during the montage, he leans over to me and says, "Hey, nice work."
Like dream come true.
Check.
Are you ready?
Up to Neverland.
Here we go.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land.
When I first made Star Wars, everybody in Hollywood said, "Well, this is a movie Disney should have made."
You're more than just fans. You're family.
It's about family, and that's what's so powerful about it.
Hey.
You use a bird to write with. It's called tweeting.
When we visit the world of Disney, we never grow old. It's a Peter Pan, never, never land that keeps us young in heart.
This is Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, and you are skywalking through Neverland. I have a good feeling about this.
Hey, Skywalkers! So, what are your favorite Star Wars memories? Does one include calling the president's office on behalf of a protocol droid? Just wondering. So, as we leave you with that, we want to welcome you to
Skywalking Through Neverland.
This is your podcast destination for the many decades of your Star Wars, Disney, and Marvel fandom. I am Richard Woloski, but now everyone please say hello to my sweetie wife, Sarah.
Yay! Hello, Skywalkers! Oh, it's so good to be back this week. We didn't think we'd get a chance to record, but here we are!
Yes.
We're recording! And it's time to give a big Wookiee hug to our family of Skywalkers. We want to thank you all for listening to the show every single week. If this is your first time tuning in, welcome! We love it when you share our joy in this adventure through fandom.
Now, we are recording this from Long Beach, California on December the 6th, 2019. All right, Sarah or Minnie, whoever answers first, how many more days until the Rise of Skywalker?
Oh, there are 14 days until December 20th.
Okay, now Minnie, you answer.
What? That was Minnie.
Well, that
can't you tell
like...
the difference?
No. You would think at this point, 10 years of marriage, I'd be able to understand your voice as opposed to Minnie Mouse's voice. I just don't sometimes.
Okay.
Because you're both so small and cute.
Aw, I'll take that.
Okay, good. Now, Sarah, I'll ask you, how many more days until the Rise of the Resistance at Disneyland? Not Disney World, because they already have it.
They do. Well, here, there are 42 more days we have to wait to experience this amazing attraction.
Hey, I put this out on Facebook this morning in our group, so any of you Skywalkers who have already gone on Rise of the Resistance over at Walt Disney World, we want to hear your reactions.
Yeah, so make sure to record a voice memo on your phone and then email that to share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com. We'd love to play your reactions on the show, not just read them, but we want to play them.
Yeah, and something that is spoiler-free, because some of us haven't been on it yet, so we don't want to have anything ruined. But just your reactions, how you felt afterwards, what your anticipation level was getting up to the attraction.
Maybe comparing it to some attractions we may know.
Any kind of excitement that you want to share with us, we would love to hear and play on the next episode.
Now, speaking of this episode of Skywalking Through Neverland is proudly sponsored by Small World Vacations. They are a diamond-level Disney vacation planner travel agency and can help you book your trip to Disney parks around the world, and their service is free of charge. So all you have to do is head to smallworldvacations.com for a no-obligation price quote and then tell them that Skywalking Through Neverland sent you. And speaking of Small World Vacations, well, they were there at the Rise of the Resistance opening at Walt Disney World. And yeah, they had some fun things to say about it too.
I think everyone, just from what I'd seen, everyone had some really ecstatic reactions.
Yeah. Although there is some downside to it, is that the ride does break down.
Well, of course.
Of course, they do.
Any ride is going to break down.
Right. But I guess it was down for like most of the day on the first day. It's like sad.
Oh.
I know. Mm-hmm. But yeah, hopefully they'll get that worked out. But yeah, you never know.
Should that be something you just expect?
I think not, so at not, this point,
not
yeah.
Not just at Disneyland, but anywhere that we've been to that has a new ride opening.
Right.
It's down most of the day.
Right, right.
So I guess we shouldn't really count on riding it until January 18th.
Oh.
Oh, and we'll be there in the morning.
Yes, we'll be there in the morning. So hopefully it won't break down by then.
Right, right.
Now, what's coming up on this episode?
Well, I'm glad you asked. We're going to be speaking with our good friend, Craig Miller. Now, Craig worked in publicity on Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back, and he created the Star Wars fan club, which later became Bantha Tracks. You know how in this day and age, if you want news, you get it like as it's happening?
Mm-hmm.
Back in the 70s and 80s, we had to wait 3 or 4 months to get the news.
Oh.
Yeah, but it was up to Craig to put all that news together and release it in the quarterly newsletter known as Bantha Tracks.
Okay, so it was quarterly, not a monthly.
Yeah, quarterly. Could you imagine that?
No, I cannot.
And we'll also be talking with Craig about his new book, Star Wars Memories, My Life in the Death Star Trenches.
And we also have
Things we want to share.
Things we want to share. Things we want to share. Things we want to share.
Okay, so Richard, things we want to share. What do we want to share?
We want to share that we have lots to share next week. All right, so because this happens every December and we apologize, but our work schedules are just so hectic and full and we didn't want to just rush things out. Mm-hmm. So Let's share the fact that we're going to share next week.
Yeah, so so what do you guys have to look forward to next week on next week's episode? Well, we just went to the Rise of Skywalker press junket. Woo!
And we got a chance to talk to Chris Terrio and producer Michelle Rejwan.
Yeah,
and
Chris
Terrio is the screenwriter. I know, I'm so excited to talk about this, but if we start talking about it now, it's just going to, this episode will never get out.
It's true.
Yeah, so Chris Terrio, the screenwriter, I really wanted to talk to him, get inside his head, and we got to sit in a round table, so there was like 6 or 7 of us, mm-hmm. asking he and Michelle Rejwan questions.
Right. It was a really cool experience, and that was after the entire press conference, where you have all the stars up there, and also that was moderated by Ava DuVernay. So that was, who's a director.
Director
of
Wrinkle
in Time. Wrinkle in Time, yes. Time. And some other movies mm-hmm. that she's mm-hmm. was much better at directing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that was a surprise. And we'll talk about all of that and then share some audio that we took from that next week.
Yeah, and that was a really busy day because they thought, wouldn't it be really fun if we had the media go from The Rise of Skywalker all the way to Hollywood for the world premiere of the animated film Spies in Disguise?
Yeah. Now, this is from Blue Sky Studios, which is owned by Fox, which is now owned by Disney.
Exactly.
So, and we even saw some of the same Disney cast members who were at the Rise of Skywalker press conference earlier that day. They were then at like the after party for the Spies in Disguise premiere. So it was a long day for them as well.
Yeah, it was because of the world premiere and the parties and, you know, hanging with Will Smith and Tom Holland and Dancing with the Stars.
It was really cool. Yeah, so Spies in Disguise is an animated film and, you know, Will Smith and Tom Holland are the stars of that movie, as well as Rashida Jones.
And Ben Mendelsohn.
Yeah.
Director Krennic.
Now, also next week, you'll have to look forward to, we'll be talking with some friends who are on the other side of the country at the Rise of the Resistance press junket.
All right, stop.
Yes.
Why not separate all this? You have the Rise of the Resistance press junket.
It was literally the same day as the Rise of Skywalker press junket. So, wow, it's just insane.
And plus, you throw in the Spies in Disguise world premiere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All in one day. who's not talking to each other over there?
And we even had some jobs that day, too, that we had to juggle between. It was, like, insane.
So, as you can tell, we got lots of stories to share from that day. And next week, we're also going to be talking with some more friends who were at the opening day for Rise of the Resistance.
Right.
The media day.
Yeah.
I want to hear so much about this right now. I want to talk about it. But once again, our day today is just so full that let's focus on Craig Miller.
Yeah.
And his awesome book, Star Wars Memories. And then next week, let the floodgates open. And before we speak with Craig, let's thank everyone who came out to our LostCon panel last week. And this was the panel where we had Paul Hirsch talk about selected scenes from the movies he had cut and go over them, give us some behind-the-scenes notes, even more stories than he had in his book a long time ago in a cutting room far, far away.
Yeah, now we shot video. We shot that whole thing on video, and that will be up on our YouTube channel come January.
Yeah, the one part that we didn't get on video is when we're watching the montage we put together for Paul Hirsch, something that I edited together and painstakingly went over every single frame. And during the montage, he leans over to me and says, "Hey, nice work."
Yeah, like twice, right?
Yeah, I did that twice.
It was so cool.
Oh my goodness. You know what? If I got anything on video, that's what I wanted on video. To have an Academy Award winning Star Wars and Empire Strikes Back editor tell me that I did a good editing job.
Aww. It was amazing. Like dream come true.
Check.
Nice. All right. Well, now it's time to welcome Craig Miller.
We are always so happy to have our good friend Craig Miller on the show. In his new book, Star Wars Memories, My Time in the Death Star Trenches, Craig gives us first-hand stories as he worked in publicity on Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back, and how he brought fandom together as the creator of the official Star Wars fan club.
You can find Craig's book at your local bookstore and Amazon.com, where it has a 100% review rating. And it also makes a great stocking stuffer or life day gift.
Hey, Craig.
Hey, Richard. Hey, Sarah. It's always my pleasure to talk to you guys.
Aw.
Well, thank you. And likewise.
Absolutely.
Hey, thanks for coming back on the show and talking about your book. Now, for the Skywalkers out there who haven't gotten the book yet, can you give us some of the book's highlights?
Well, okay. It's a much bigger book than I thought it was going to be when I started writing it. It's about the making of Star Wars and Empire from my perspective there as director of fan relations and a publicist and producer on special projects like Sesame Street and TV commercials. And it also includes four never-before-seen interviews with George Lucas, Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, and Tony Daniels done conducted by me between the making of Star Wars and Empire.
Wow.
Were these done for the fan club and just never released?
Well, they were done by me for general purposes. Parts of them appeared in Bantha tracks, and the rest of it was just for my reference for general publicity purposes, quotes we might use, that kind of thing.
Excellent.
Well, did you have these stuffed in a drawer waiting for this moment?
They were on ancient audio cassettes in my office drawer that a sound designer friend of mine who's worked on many major motion pictures reprocessed the delicate 40-year-old, you know, reel cassette tapes and digitized them. And then they went to a different friend of mine who was a transcriber who transcribed them.
Nice.
Now, what is your favorite memory that you had so much fun recounting you had included in your book?
Boy, that's tough. There you know, I'm not saying this just because I want to encourage people to buy my book, although I do. but there are a lot of things that, you know, I was just out of college when I got hired by Lucasfilm. I loved science fiction. I loved movies. And suddenly I was in the middle of, you know, the biggest dream a kid could have. And so much of it was exciting to me. I think the episodes of Sesame Street were particularly fun. We brought Tony Daniels in from London. I got to operate R2-D2 for them. And I oversaw and supervised the shooting of 5 segments of Sesame Street.
Wow. You know,
tell us the story again about how Anthony Daniels, almost didn't make the Sesame Street shoot.
I'd come up with the idea of doing this, and Sesame Street said they thought it was great, and everyone at Lucasfilm thought it was great. So we went ahead and, you know, made all the arrangements, made sure Tony was available at that time, and all of that. And then a week before we were supposed to shoot, which was the 1st of November of 1979, I suddenly thought, does Tony need a work visa to come into the country? Mm-mm. And of course he did. Mm. And I tried calling, you know, the whatever department it is, I don't remember anymore, that handles visas like that, immigration or something. And they said, oh, well, you know, he's just a guy in a suit. His face is covered. We can't give him a special visa, and a normal visa will take 6 weeks.
Oh, how the ignorance.
Yeah, and they were like, anyone could wear the suit. And I was like, no. And I tried explaining to them that, you know, he was someone special. Just because his face was covered didn't matter. But, you know, federal bureaucrats. So I tried to think of who we might know who was a fan of Star Wars. And Jimmy Carter was president at the time, and I thought about Amy Carter because she was a big Star Wars fan, but she was still, you know, a young kid, and was like, how do I get a hold of her? And then she would have to go to someone to you know, do anything. So I decided to call one of California's U.S. senators, who I have no idea if he was interested in Star Wars, but Alan Cranston was a very powerful senator. He'd been in there a long time. He knew, you know, he was a big deal maker in the Senate. And I called his office and I explained to his assistant that who was, what I wanted, and how we wanted to bring one of the children of the world's favorite characters to the world's favorite TV show, Sesame Street, in what the UN had declared the International Year of the Child. And could they help? And they said, call this number, which was the New York office of whatever department it was, immigration or whatever. And I said, okay. And I called the number. This was a Friday. I said to the person who answered, you know, I told them how, you know, we needed to get this visa. And they said, oh, it couldn't possibly get done in less than 6 weeks. And then I said, well, Senator Cranston told me if I called you, you'd take care of it. Mm. They put me on hold. And I was on hold for like 5, 6, 7 minutes. And finally they came back and said, if you can get someone who has some authority from Lucasfilm or Children's Television Workshop to our office today, it was a Friday, we will have the visa.
Jeez.
So I called the general counsel for Children's Television Workshop, which is the organization that does Sesame Street. They've since changed their name to Sesame Workshop, but that was their name then. And I said, you guys forgot to get Tony a visa.
Nice.
And he was sort of, oh, crap. And I said, but I've fixed it. you just have to get someone down to thus and such a location, have them sign the paperwork.
Right.
And so they did. And we got the guy from the, you know, visa office to stay overtime on a Friday, which tells you how powerful Cranston was, a federal civil servant stayed overtime. They signed the paperwork. And then in London, Tony's car, it got processed. Tony was flying in on, I guess it was a Wednesday. It was Halloween. We all flew in on Halloween. The limo we sent picked him up, drove him to the American Embassy. He picked up his visa, drove on to Heathrow, and flew into into New York for the show.
Wow.
Of the dozens and dozens of stories in your book, I think that one's my favorite. It just shows the spinning plates you had to deal with.
Oh, yeah. The behind the scenes. Like, right. We never know.
Right. And they're all firsthand stories.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was an exciting time, and we were kind of making things up as we went along on, you know, promoting Star Wars and Empire. It was very early in those days of, you know, we had no internet. Science fiction was still, you know, sort of the unappreciated stepchild of the movie industry. And so we just had to figure out how to get it to work.
Did Anthony ever know about what it took to get him there?
I don't think I ever told him the whole story. He knew he had to stop and pick up the visa. But, you know, there was no reason to tell him that we all forgot. And, you know, it's just not something we usually dealt with. That, you know, when you're working on a film, there are whole departments that deal with that kind of thing. But right. This was not that, and no one thought about it. But anyway, there's no reason. You don't bother telling the actors about the things you did to get them there. You just want to impress them with how wonderful they are, and how much you appreciate what they're doing.
And that's a good producer.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Speaking of good producers, Gary Kurtz, who was the producer of Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back, he wrote your foreword.
Yes.
Did he get a chance to read the final draft before he passed away?
Gary didn't read the very final draft. He passed away last September, but he had read, you know, an interim draft, you know. Books are like paintings, you know, and movies. They don't get finished. They just sort of reach the point they get yanked out of your hand and have to be released. So you're always tinkering with them. But Gary and I have been friends and coworkers for 40 years. After Star Wars Empire, he asked me to come work with him on The Dark Crystal and later Return to Oz and other projects. And we had another film project we were working on when he took ill. So he hadn't read the very final draft, but he had read much of the book before he passed away. And he wrote he very generously wrote the foreword for me. So I appreciated that. We greatly miss Gary.
Oh, yeah. Don't we all?
He was a good friend and, you know, just a terrific guy.
Were there any stories that you had written where he had said, didn't it happen this way?
No, he didn't offer any changes or suggestions like that. I think he was happy with everything that's in the book.
Okay.
Oh, that's good. Cause I know when you tell someone a story that's like, wait a minute, no, they happened this way. Cause it happens to me every single day.
Right.
Oh, the mind. Now, I know we've talked about your book in the past, and the one thing that was holding you up was getting rights to use certain photographs. Did you get clearance to all the photos that you wanted?
The photos come from a lot of different sources, and they are mostly in there with the approval of the people behind them. Some of them come from the internet. There's a photo of me in the book that has been in my possession since 1979, but I have no idea who took the picture. It's a photo of me giving the Empire Strikes Back presentation at the San Diego Comic-Con.
Wow.
in 1979. And I have no idea who took it. I have no memory of that. So technically, I couldn't ask the photographer for permission, but I figure no one's probably going to care, if, you know, and if someone, so if someone who did took it, contacts me and says, "Oh, I took that picture," be like, "Oh, great! Now I know, and I can give them credit in the book because I can always revise it." I have no idea who to ask.
You know wow. what's going to happen now. Everyone's going to come forward and say, "Hey, that was me. I took that."
Yeah, of course, they have to be someone who was there in 1979 and who knew me to take the photo and to give me the copy.
Exactly. Yeah, like I could come forward and say, "Oh, it was me," but I wasn't born yet.
So there's a very narrow pool of who it could have been. And most people, it's impossible for it to have been.
Right.
So no, Sarah, it was not you.
No.
Well, it's like the photo of me in Gary Kurtz's office sorting through all the Empire Strikes Back slides, which is also in the book, is similarly a Polaroid. And that one I know, Bunny Alsup, who was Gary's assistant on Star Wars and Empire, took the photo and gave me the picture.
Okay. So you know that one. Is there one picture in your book that always brings a smile to your face?
Yeah, I mean, I guess there are a lot. There are really only four or five photos that I'm in. You know, back in the 70s, we didn't all carry cameras in our pockets. And so we don't have a lot of photos of ourselves. The one that's kind of my favorite, I use it a lot, especially when I'm doing Star Wars stuff, is the one that's on the cover of the book, which is me in the ice cave in front of the Millennium Falcon. That's kind of hard not to love. I used it on the cover because it, you know, I think it's a great photo and it certainly says, yes, I was there to have Star Wars memories.
Absolutely.
Do you recall who took that picture of you in Echo Base?
That was taken by the unit photographer on Empire Strikes Back. Because of union and company rules, only the unit photographer could take photos. And because of secrecy, the company didn't want anyone else to take photos. The only other person at L3 Studios who was taking photos, I mean, people, I suppose, could have been sneaking photos, but it's a lot harder to hide a camera back then. But the only other one who was regularly taking photos was Gary Kurtz.
Were there any pictures that you just couldn't get clearance for your book?
No, not really.
Okay.
Well, good. Good. Because I just saw your book at LostCon, and I couldn't believe how many pictures were in there and how many rare pictures. Just when you think you've seen it all, no, you haven't.
Well, it's not a photo book. I don't want anyone to mistake that. There are a bunch of photos, only a handful really from the shoot of Empire. But they're illustrating a bunch of different stories and articles. And I tell you, almost everything is on the internet. I didn't own copies of a lot of them, but if you know what you want to find a photo of, Google is your friend and it can help you find specific photos. I found a lot of them on the internet and some of them people knew who took them and others, no one knows who took them. And some were taken by friends of mine from over the 40 years who are Star Wars fans. There are some photos that have not been published before, but a lot of them are merely very rare and you have to know the secret corners to look in.
Did you leave any stories on the editing room floor for the revision?
I mean, I'm sure there's things I didn't include, but no stories I deliberately left out.
Okay.
At over 100,000 words, it's pretty much all the stories I have. At least the ones people would care about.
Right. I can see a book coming from you that expands beyond your work on Star Wars and Empire and the what you've been doing within the fandom communities, either going to conventions and talking to people, going to the new Star Wars premieres, and just your point of view on fandom and Star Wars as a whole.
Well, actually, the response to Star Wars Memories has been so good that I started talking about doing a second book once we get through the first wave of doing stuff with this book, called possibly More Movie Memories, talking about my working on Dark Crystal and Return to Oz, Muppets Take Manhattan, The Last Starfighter, Excalibur, Altered States, Black Cauldron, Real Genius, dozens of 1980s science fiction and fantasy films, and stuff I've done since then in the animation world.
Oh, great.
Working on stuff like G.I. Joe and Beast Wars and Curious George and the Smurfs.
Oh, see, wow. I knew there was more stories left in you.
Yeah, I think that would be fantastic. I mean, yeah. Star Wars has been covered like by so many angles and so many people, but like these films that you just mentioned, Real Genius and Dark Crystal and all of those, like I would love to hear more inside information on these films.
Well, I hope that the stories I've got in my Star Wars book are ones people haven't heard. I've tried to keep away from the stuff that's been covered by other people. Yeah, I didn't work as long or as closely on most of these other films. I was 3.5 years more than full time on the Star Wars movies. Other movies I worked on for 6 months and not as closely. Mm. But I still have plenty of, which is why it would be a book covering lots of movies, not just a couple like here.
You were selling books at LostCon and signing the books. Do you have any signings coming up?
Well, this coming weekend, I'm going to be at EmpireCon, again here in Los Angeles, an all Star Wars convention where they've given me a table and I'll be signing books.
And for those who don't know, EmpireCon is the big unofficial Star Wars convention with a focus on the original trilogy, but we'll still have guests from recent shows like Clone Wars and Rebels, Resistance.
Oh, and The Mandalorian.
Yeah, so this is going to be huge, and I'm so sorry that Sarah and I can't make it there.
I know, it'll be held at the Marriott Los Angeles Airport Hotel on December 6th through 8th.
You're not going to be there.
No, we got to be working.
How can it be a Star Wars event without you guys?
Because it's December on a weekend, and we will be working.
And that is how nice of you to say.
Will you be hosting any panels there at EmpireCon?
Right now, just the talk I'm giving, which is Friday afternoon, about, you know, the basically telling a lot of my stories with slides. There's also a remembrance for Gary Kurtz, and I suspect I'll be part of that, although we haven't talked about it. And other than that, I'll pretty much be at my table or going through all the exhibits. They're doing an exhibit of Gary's archive, or part of Gary's archive, and a bunch of stuff for Kenny Baker and Peter Mayhew.
Wow. Oh. That's going to be amazing.
Is there a chance we can talk Jason Joyner into moving this to, like, April?
Well, let's see how well he does with it.
All right, Craig, once again, thank you very much for coming on and telling us about your book and some of the fun stories. And once again, your book, Star Wars Memories, My Time in the Death Star Trenches, is available now and is filled with so many fascinating stories you won't hear anywhere else.
That wraps up episode 268 of
Skywalking Through Neverland.
We'd like to thank Craig Miller for coming on the show once again and sharing his stories. And we want to thank all you Skywalkers for joining us every single week and watching our YouTube videos and buying our shirts.
Oh, yes, they're flying off the shelves. That I Have Spoken shirt. Wow, that's like the breakout t-shirt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and plus the new holiday shirt with Baby Yoda.
With Baby Yoda!
Disney and Lucasfilm, if you're not going to put stuff out on the shelves, we will.
It's true. So Baby Yoda is force presenting a new hand to Olaf on this holiday shirt. And it's so cute. And it looks great on some of the long sleeve tee colors that we have. Like, yeah, those have been also doing very well in our TeePublic shop.
And we'd also like to thank our sponsor, Small World Vacations. Thinking of a trip to the Disney parks? Well, you should right now, because
absolutely.
Rise of the Resistance. And if you're going to be doing that, you can fill out a get a quote form at smallworldvacations.com today. And their vacation planning service is free. How much is that, Sarah?
$0.
Free of charge. So check it out and tell them Skywalking Through Neverland sent you.
Now on Wednesdays, we YouTube. If you had been paying attention to YouTube, you might have noticed that at 6 p.m. we were on the blue carpet for the premiere of Spies in Disguise. And so we shared a little live YouTube video from the blue carpet.
Mm-hmm. And Kate Flannery
yes.
from The Office was in our video.
Oh,
she didn't know she was in our video.
No.
But we caught her as she was walking the blue carpet.
It's true. And we got to speak with her later on, and we'll tell that story.
Yeah, it was a very weird video because we were in a place where we didn't think we were supposed to be. But then again, that's why we spend most of our lives.
It's true.
So we had to be really discreet while we're YouTubing.
So you never know what you're going to get in our YouTube live videos on Wednesdays. And especially in December
mm-hmm.
when things are crazy.
Now, please check out the rest of the shows on our Skywalking Network.
Skynet.
Including classic Marvel Star Wars comics, Sabers and Spells, and Talking Apes. And you can find them all over there at skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
We want to give a huge thank you for everyone who is part of the Skywalking Force. If you would like more Skywalking Through Neverland in your life or just want to support us, please check out skywalkingforce.com. And if you'd like to support us in a different way, please share the show with a friend or buy t-shirts or mugs. Our designs look really cool on mugs. My parents had a Skywalker's Rise mug. I believe they shared in our Facebook group, and that looked totally cool.
Oh, hey, did you share the pillow?
I have not yet. If we were live, I'd show it to people. But we got a pillow of I Have Spoken, and it looks so cool.
Looks,
and so every week when we go live, I'll be using that at the very end of our episodes. So in order to find our TeePublic shop, just head to skywalkingthroughneverland.com and click on the Support Us tab. You'll find a link to the entire shop right there. And make sure to scroll up and down and see all the designs available. There's lots of sales going on right now at TeePublic.
And you can find Skywalking Through Neverland over there at jedinews.co.uk and Fanthatrax.
You can also find us on social media where we're tweeting from all the crazy events we're going to be attending in December. And you can do that. We are at Skywalking Pod for Twitter and Instagram. We also have our Facebook group. So just search Facebook for Skywalking Through Neverland group and request to join. You can also email us and email your voicemails. Maybe you've done something fun this year or bought something cool or have ridden Rise of the Resistance. So send a voice memo through the email to share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And please leave us a review over there at Apple Podcasts or Stitcher. We'd love to hear what you Skywalkers have to say. And leave us as many stars as you want.
That's right.
5 is good.
We would love that. I have spoken.
And always remember,
Neverland on Alderaan.
Some imagination, huh?
To our Skywalkers and Tweetwalkers, thanks for listening. Skywalking Through Neverland is created and produced by Richard and Sarah Woloski. Original music by Rob Dellinger. Creative consultant, Mark Ogushewitz. Technical advisor, Peter Heitman. Facebook administrators, Donald Wicks, Joey Pittman, and Norma Heitman.
Skywalking Through Neverland is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Any sounds, music, and clips played during this podcast are the property of their copyright holders. All original content is property of Skywalking Through Neverland, all rights reserved. Sorry, had to be said.
McClunkey.